software again this morning, so that's why you don't see announcements up there. I hope you don't remember what we sang last week, because we're going to sing it again this week. So that's where we're at. That's what we've got to choose from. So let's stand this morning. Let's lift our voices together and sing, "Bless Your Name." You may have a seat. Today is Communion Sunday, as you've probably already noticed, so we have put the offering containers up here. So when you come up and get the elements this morning, if you have offering today, please put it in those containers. The stand at the back at the entrance is for our benevolent offering. So we do that once a month during communion. So if you'd like to contribute to our benevolent fund, which goes and takes care of the needs of people in our church, please do that. Aftermath, which we usually have after service, we will not have again until next week. As you know, Pastor Jerry is gone on vacation, and so we will get back to that when he returns. Everybody doing okay today? Good? Good. Let's stand again and sing Wonder Working God. You may have a seat this morning. Our scripture reading today, we won't have it on the screen, but I'll read it to you this morning. It's from Psalms 111, the 111th chapter, verses 1 through 4. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. In the assembly of the godly and in the congregation, the Lord's deeds are great, eagerly awaited by all who desire them. And if I can turn the page. His work is majestic and glorious, and his faithfulness endures forever. He does amazing things that will be remembered. The Lord is merciful and compassionate.
Songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melody, sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love.
So we're pleased to have Adam Parmenter again back with us this morning. As you know, Pastor Jerry and Annette are on vacation, and they should be back with us next Sunday. But this week we have Adam with us again. And so, Adam, come bring the word this morning.
Good morning. And I'm bringing my phone up here with the alarm clock set so that I... Because one thing I can't do is wear my glasses and wear this microphone. So I can see the clock back there, but it's actually pretty blurry. So I want to have some way to make sure I end at an appropriate time. So if you were here last week, you remember we spoke about love, and I still had this temptation to have the Beatles playing in the background. You know, love is all you need. That's what we think about. We think of flowers. We think of that new movie that's going to be on Netflix, Marry Me, you know, ooh, love, right? And what we talked about was that love is so much more than that. That without love, our best actions and our best words and our best sacrifices have zero value to us and to the kingdom of God. And what I ended up doing, because it wasn't in my notes, was telling some stories from Scripture because they were heavy on my mind. And I thought, okay, why did I do that? And I was, you know, lost in my notes completely. And luckily, you know, hopefully it was a good message. But as I went through the week, you know, as a good preacher, I think I would just continue in 1 Corinthians 13 and talk about all the words used and what they really mean for us and how can we put them into practice. And I could not get out of my mind this story from Scripture. I couldn't escape it. And so I thought maybe that was from the Lord. So I decided to go back and dive into this story in greater depth. And it's almost difficult to talk about it. I'm almost moved to tears when I see the forgiveness offered. And we were having communion today, which is a celebration of Christ's sacrifice on the cross, a celebration of forgiveness. When I see the forgiveness offered, and you see the two main characters in the story, one who freely receives, and the other whose heart is hard, and one who is righteous and one who is not, and the surprising answer to which one is which. So turn with me to the Gospel of Luke. And what we're going to see is I'm also going to point out where we see Jesus giving an example of things in 1 Corinthians 13, because he definitely does. Gospel of Luke chapter 7, and we'll start with verse 36. And I'll read the whole passage and then we'll pray. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to him, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon," now don't be confused, this isn't Simon Peter or Simon the Zealot, this is a different Simon. There's like a lot of Simons in the Bible, it's a very common name. So this is a Pharisee by the name of Simon. "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Oh, tell me, teacher." "Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, that's about a year and a half's wages. The other owed him 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled." Then he turned toward the woman and said, "Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." And the other guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this that even forgives sins?" And Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I ask today for your Spirit's guidance to help me unpack this story, to put it into color with the brilliance that is there, often hidden from us. I ask that you will open our eyes to your forgiveness, to your grace, to your great love, and your patience and your kindness, and that today you would inspire us by your Spirit to also share that same love with others. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, there's a lot about this story that seems really strange. We don't often know, people aren't often kissing feet and pouring, and actually Jesus complained, "You didn't pour oil on my head." I'd be like, "Dude, get away from me with that bottle of oil. What are you doing?" And you would too. You'd be like, if you were at a friend's house and someone poured oil on your head, I might go back to my wife and say, "All right, can we go?" So what I want to do this morning is unpack it. I want to give you the what really is going on, so it makes sense to what made sense to them. Now, first, I want to explain. There's a difference in what we call genre. Now you're like, okay, what's a genre? I mean, you probably already know that, but we know there's two kinds of genre we're familiar with: fiction and nonfiction. And, you know, like Marvel superhero movies, those are fiction. And then, if we see a history about Abraham Lincoln, it hopefully is nonfiction, but sometimes we watch historical fiction. You know, and so if there's a historical fiction about Abraham Lincoln, and at one point he goes, hey man, let's do it. You're like, okay, that's fiction because they didn't talk that way. And we know how to discern, and if we're reading fiction, we read it differently. The same is true about a textbook, which we would call teaching text. Sometimes a textbook would describe something, like it would describe history. Other times it would tell us how to do something, how to do a math problem. The same is true for scriptures. There are some scriptures that are teaching that tell us to do something. It says, love one another. John 13:34, love one another. But then in 1 Corinthians 13, it just describes love. Love is patient. It's not a command, but it's still teaching us about love. So when we read the scriptures, we need to ask ourselves, is this a story, a narrative? Is what we all, that's the big word. If you haven't been to seminary, remember the word narrative. And then you can look at someone and say, well, that's a narrative passage. And they'll think, wow, that person's got, really knows something. But there's different kinds of stories because Jesus told parables, and parables are pretend. It's a made up, it's a fictional story intended to teach a lesson. And in this case, this is not a parable. This is a historical account. It really happened. The things that we see here said actually were said in the way that they were said in this account. None of it's made up. Now, where it's placed, we don't know the exact timing because Jesus walked the earth and had his ministry for 3 years, and we see only part of that captured in Scripture, but we know that it really did happen. So when we see that in Scripture, what we need to do in order to get the message from God and to learn is to do what we do with any story, ask who, what, why, when, and put ourselves in the story. So this morning, I don't have slides, but I want you to do is use your imagination. And if you need to close your eyes to do it, you go ahead. And if you accidentally fall asleep, that's all right. I don't have my glasses on. I can't tell if your eyes are open. If you snore, if the person next to you starts snoring, just, you know, don't be gentle and kind, all right? Just give them a little nudge. But I really hope you'll use your imagination and then ask yourself, what would I feel like if I were this person back then? Not like now, but if I were that person, if I had their thoughts, their expectations, if what they wanted was what I wanted, how would I feel? How would I react? Because that's how you learn from the stories, by getting inside it, allowing yourself to be the characters and thinking about what the example is that Christ provides and the example that you see. Now, let's talk about the when. Well, we don't know exactly when in Jesus' life this happened, but we know what happened prior to this. And I'm not going to read it, but if you look in the prior chapter, you see that Jesus went to a city by the name of Nain. Did I get that right? We don't often have cities by that name. Yeah, Nain. And it was in the Galilee region. And you got to remember, really, there's kind of like the cool section and the not cool section of Israel at that time. You had near Jerusalem where all the good people were, and that was the city of David, and you know. And then if the farther north you went, you got more with the hillbillies and the ruffians, and that's where Jesus grew up. That's one of the reasons the Pharisees disrespected him. They didn't realize he was born in Bethlehem, the city of David, the fulfillment of prophecy. They just couldn't get past the fact that he grew up in Nazareth. Oh, no, no one of that's anybody. So that's where he was during much of his ministry. We call it the Galilean portion of his ministry. And he was in the city of Nain. And at that point, people were eager to hear what he had to say. They'd probably seen some miracles already. And so a large crowd followed him. Now, we don't know how large that was. But even if it was just, say, 50 people or 100 people following along, eager to see what he's going to do, eager to see what he's going to say, and they encounter another large crowd, which is a funeral procession. And Jesus' heart is filled with compassion because it's a woman whose son has died. It's her only son. And in that day and age, when you grew old and your children had families and your husband would die, your children would provide for your material needs. Now she had no son. She was looking not only at the grief of loss, she had no grandchildren, she had no son. She could starve. She could go hungry. And so her grief and the tragedy was weighing on her, and Jesus said, stop, and the funeral procession stopped, and he touched the boy, and he came back to life and started talking. And a large crowd saw that. And then if you look, as we get into verse 21, It said he healed many people and many diseases. So as we come into the end of chapter 7, many people have seen his miracles. He is seen as a prophet. He is considered a rabbi because he teaches the people. And people are starting probably to ask, could this be the Messiah? In fact, I don't remember where it is, but there's one point where someone said, if the Messiah comes, will he do more than Jesus does? So, because, you know, he controlled the weather, he healed the sick, he raised the dead. Could this man be the Messiah? Now, the people were eager for a Messiah, for a Savior. Now, we don't always share that. I want you to understand why they wanted that, why they craved it. Some people wanted it but didn't really pay attention to the Scriptures. Other people were digging through the text. Now, of course, if you owned a copy of the Hebrew Scriptures, that meant you were wealthy because it came on giant scrolls. So, but still, they would go to synagogue, they would memorize it, they would think about it, they would talk about it. Why were they eager for a Messiah? Because they remembered they had once been God's chosen people. They remembered that King David had once been their king, the most powerful king in history. And they also remembered with shame that they had ignored God, that they had started, their people had started pursuing false gods, and that the Spirit of God actually left the temple, and then they became conquered by nation after nation, and now the Roman Empire ruled the world, and it was a pagan empire that worshipped false gods. And so everyone was aware that they had fallen away, that they had lost something important. And so when they said the word Messiah, Savior, we hear saving from my sins and forgiveness, they didn't always hear that. Many of them would have heard military ruler. He's going to sweep in out of nowhere, and he's going to go wipe out a bunch of Romans, and then we're going to gather up behind him, and then we're going to march to victory. They were eager for a Messiah. But the Pharisees were certain that it was not Jesus of Nazareth, the guy from the hick town of Nazareth. Not going to happen. Not possible. They hated Jesus. Now, the Pharisees were, you ever met someone that knows everything about the Bible and they make sure they let you know that they're following it and maybe you're not? You know, we would refer to that person as a Pharisee for good reason. They started out as the guardians of the faith, helping people return back to an observant life of following God. They didn't start out as what we see them now, but there were about 6,000 of them during Jesus' time, and the common people trusted them to teach them about how to honor God. But the Pharisees had missed one important thing, and I'm skipping a lot of things for today. You know, I'm not going to tell you everything about the Pharisees, because I know there's someone in the congregation now going, he missed a few things about them. I'm going to, because we only have a short amount of time. But the one important thing about the Pharisees is they missed what the commandments really meant. The commandments that God gave in the Old Testament were intended to make it clear to the people that they were sinful and that they needed forgiveness and that they would go to God and ask for forgiveness and receive forgiveness. God, you know, if you look in the prophecies after a while, there's times where God will say, I don't care about your, don't bring me one more animal. I don't want any more blood on the altar. I'm sick of it. What I want is a repentant heart. And that's what the commandments were intended to do. That what the Pharisees said is, if we can follow the commandments, we are righteous. What that means is we're righteous on our own. And so they not only had the Ten Commandments and all the other, you know, if you look in Leviticus, all the laws about sacrifices, but they created their own rules, 365 of them, or 366, in addition to the Ten Commandments, just to make sure they were doing things right. And if you could follow them, then you were righteous. Well, the Pharisees saw Jesus as a threat because he didn't get up and talk about the rules. He didn't get up and honor their, you know, the great Pharisees of times of old. He simply spoke on behalf of God and spoke with authority because he is God. And he was threatening their position, because not only they had become the people in power, you have to follow the Pharisees if you want to have a good life. And now he was disrupting that. In fact, John chapter 11, verse 48, a Pharisee says, if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and then the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation. So you remember last Sunday I said, sometimes people do things that just kind of boggle our minds. They say mean things to each other, or they do things. Why are people doing that? Because, you know, it's not like in movies where you have a villain who's just evil because he likes being evil. Typically, people are doing things that are rude or hurtful because they're trying to protect something. And so as wrong as the Pharisees are, they're trying to protect what's good. They're trying to protect what's great about Israel. Finally, they have peace, and they can go about their business and ignore Rome, and Rome will ignore them. And oh, by the way, they're getting wealthy in the process. So they have what they want, what they need, the way they like it. And Jesus was upsetting all that. So that is the setting that brings us to this passage of Scripture. And one Pharisee by the name of Simon, invited Jesus to a meal. Now, why did he do that if he hated him? Well, Jesus may have been speaking at their synagogue. He would go and speak in the synagogues, and as a rabbi visiting in a church, kind of like me today, they would invite him to get up and say a few words. Now, or it may have been that this was a special occasion just for Jesus. So in this day and age, if you were someone of great importance, like a Pharisee or a noble person, you could hold a meal and invite other important people over to sit at the table. And then the common folk of the community would come and stand around the perimeter of the room. Now, I want you to picture not a table like we're used to, something a little lower to the ground. And around it are little cots or cushions, and if I lay down, I'll be off camera. But what you would do is you didn't sit in a chair, but you would lie down at these cushions with your elbow on the table so you could reach the food, and your feet were always as far away from the table, because no one wore shoes, not even the camels and the cattle that pooped on the ground. So by the time you got to the meal, your feet were dusty and dirty and who knows what else, and smelly probably. So that was one reason they did that. And I don't know why they didn't have chairs like we do, but they didn't. So you would recline at the table, and that's where the candles were and the lighting was. They didn't have windows like we do. Remember, their homes were made out of mud bricks, so it's easy for us to put in windows. For them to put in a window was to weaken the structure of their home. So you would have had a window or two, but not as many as we have now. And the light would have been in the center of the table, and the edges of the room probably would have been a little darker. Lots of shadows, and that's where the common people would stand, kind of back against the wall, and then listen. It was reality TV in Jesus' day. No, really, I mean, and they would hear what the smart people, what the important people had to say, and it was exciting. And then, of course, so the person hosting the meal would probably make sure word got out so that the common folks could come and listen. Now, what would happen when the guest arrived? Let's say the guest of honor especially. What would happen is the host would want to show proper respect. So when the guest arrived, he would give him a kiss on the cheek, which was a way to show honor to someone. Kind of like, and the French do that still. They kiss each other on the cheek. It's not romantic or sexual in any way. It's just a way, it's like shaking hands. Then, and if you didn't kiss the guest of honor on the cheek, that would be kind of a like if someone came and I said, I refuse to shake their hand. They would feel slighted. So the next thing that would happen is the guest of honor, they would pour oil, probably olive oil, on their head, and that was another way to show honor. But it also, in that dry climate, you know, the guest of honor might kind of wipe it in and go, hey, thanks, that feels great. Because they didn't have a conditioner, and they didn't, you know, they're out in the middle of a desert, kind of. So that was something that they probably did anyway on a regular basis. And so this was a way, again, for me to show honor as the host to the guest of honor. And then, when I would then find I would be directed here, sit here, and I would get on my couch with my head near the table and my feet out there, a servant would come by with a bowl of water and wash my feet and dry them off, which was another way to show kindness, but also that meant the room didn't smell so bad. I mean, it was just something that was common whenever you had guests. So who is at this table? Well, it's Simon the Pharisee, And he would have been greeting his guests by name as each came in, and that would allow everyone to hear the guest's name. Maybe he would have said, "This is Jeremiah, the one who owns the mercantile." And the people around the edge would go, "Oh, yeah, I know who he is. He's..." And this is Rabbi Gamaliel, and welcome. And he would, you know, and the people around, the common folk would, "Oh, he's brilliant," you know. And they, it would have, you know, the, it's kind of like the football game where the quarterback runs in and then all the different players run in and they announce the names on TV. It was kind of like that for them. But here's something that happened that we find out later. Well, I'm sorry, who else was at the table? Well, other Pharisees, other important people. Who else is in the room? Common folks, you know, the day laborers, the poor, just the rabble. The Pharisees kind of looked down on them, but they knew that they were, "Wait a minute, who's that?" That's what, I'm sorry, no, I don't mean, I'm just, that's what, everybody's like, everybody's looking around. I didn't mean to freak you out. In the text, it says, "Behold," which means, "Whoa, look, a sinful woman was there." In fact, when she heard Jesus was coming, she intentionally got an alabaster flask of perfume and brought it with her. Now, understand, I mean, I could go get all the perfume I want, which I actually don't wear perfume, but the only place to get alabaster was in Egypt. It's marble, and it was quarried out of a marble quarry, you know, and so they didn't have trucks, they didn't have the tools we have, so that... just that alabaster vial was really expensive, and the perfume in it would have been more like oil. You know, we have perfume that feels like water, but they used oil, and they put the fragrance in, you know, an olive oil or some other kind of expensive oil for that. And she might have worn it as a necklace, because that was something common for women to do, to wear this vial and carry that with them. She intentionally grabbed this extremely expensive vial of perfume and took it with her. This says something about her intent, something about the condition of her heart already. And she walks in, and maybe no one noticed her come in because there were probably shadows around the edge of the room, or maybe a few people looked down and went, "Oh, her," because she was a sinful woman. Probably what that means is she was a sexually immoral person, probably or possibly even a prostitute. And she was there with the express purpose of seeing Jesus, and she brought this perfume because she would have, if she, the only thing she would have used it would be to anoint herself or Jesus. And I doubt she, you know, ran all the way to a Pharisee's house to you know, pour perfume on herself. She was there to anoint the head of Jesus. So I want you to imagine, maybe you can imagine you're her, or imagine you're in the room and she's standing there, and she probably would have stood back into the shadows because she's not a woman that people expect to come, you know, to a Pharisee's house. She definitely doesn't measure up to what the Pharisees call for. She's definitely not good enough. And she would have stood there and she would have watched Jesus come in, and, you know, she was excited to see him walk in the room, and then she would have kind of looked in horror as he walks in and is seated. And no one has kissed him on the cheek. The host of honor maybe said hi or something, but then ignored him. And Jesus went and had a seat, and she's shocked. What happened? And maybe she's waiting for him to say, "Oh, I'm sorry, did I miss you?" No, he doesn't. He just lets Jesus go sit down. Does he pour oil on Jesus' head? No. And she's starting to feel upset because Jesus is being so dishonored, and then no one washes his feet. And he just sits there, and she is standing. She wanted to be close to him, and she is standing at his feet, kind of in the shadows, and this is too much for her to take. She's heartbroken by this, and she begins to weep. Now, if you look up the Greek word, of course, you know, the New Testament was written in Greek and Aramaic. They didn't speak English. If you look up that word, it has, the part of the definition is to weep or wail. And I'm trying to picture the room, and the people are beginning to enter and sit down and talk, and Jesus is getting snubbed. All right, this wasn't a mistake. This was intentional. We'll show him, right? and he's being snubbed. The God of creation, the God of the universe, Simon the Pharisee should be worshiping him. Instead, he's snubbing him and feeling probably, you know, if you snub someone, it's not because you feel bad about it. You snub someone and then you feel all much better about yourself. It used to happen to me when I was in school. The bullies would pick on me and it made them feel this big and they thought it made me this small. You know, that's what people do, and that's what this guy was doing. And she's seeing this, and she begins to weep, but it wasn't just a few sniffles, because she wept hard enough that as she bent over in grief, her tears fell down on Jesus' feet, and she probably looked down and saw it, and she just let it pour. She let her grief come out. I'm guessing she felt repentant. She felt grief over sin. She admitted, yes, I'm a sinner. And she saw the one she'd come to love, the Savior, being snubbed, and the grief was so strong that she wept alive. I've never wept that many tears. Well, there's no way to do that quietly. There's no way to do that without making sound. I mean, I've been through some grief this year, and I'm glad I was the only one at home when it happened, and I was I've never wept like that. I can't imagine her being quiet. Don't you wonder what the people in the room were kind of like, maybe inching away, trying to... You ever been in a room where someone's doing something that doesn't fit in, and everybody just tries to, like, ignore it, and they wait for the smart people, like the Simon the Pharisee, to do something, and you stand there, and you just kind of shuffle out of the way? But as she began to weep on his feet and saw the mud and the dust start to fall away as all the moisture from her tears, she thought, I should wipe his feet off, but I don't have a towel. And I, of course, thought, well, why didn't she use the edge of her robe? But it wouldn't have been clean either. I mean, they walked around and the dust and the dirt got on their clothes. And if you're weeping that hard, you're blowing snot, baby. I just want to be on it. And so she had to be, I mean, you have to wipe your nose on someplace. What's the only clean thing she has to wipe his feet off with? Well, that'd be her hair. Now understand this. Think this through. We wear our hair down. Well, of course, my hair's short. Women with long hair wear their hair down all the time. It's not a problem. In that society, for a woman to put her hair down was like going naked. If you didn't walk around if you went around, la, 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 going shopping with your hair down, people would be like, because that was considered the height of indecency to have your hair down. So now, she probably would have had her hair up. And so she had to embarrass herself to wipe his feet off. But there's no hint of hesitation here. And what really is interesting to me is that she anointed him to show honor, to show respect. But she couldn't get past his feet. And I've puzzled over that. If she's forward enough to not worry about what people think and wipe his feet off, sometimes you do things when you're so caught up that you would never do. And she was so caught up with grief and a desire to give him honor, she just didn't probably think about what people were thinking, but something stopped her from going past his feet. And I think that she didn't feel worthy. I don't think she felt worthy to go up all the way to his head. I think she just only felt worthy to be at his feet. And we see in Scripture, when Jesus is in the book of Revelation and they see him in the glorified state, his feet are like burning bronze. That's a sign of judgment. And we see people fall at his feet when they see him face to face. And I think she felt such repentance, and she probably felt shame. Why wouldn't she? Everybody else was shaming her. Why? You know, how did she get to the place she was in her life? It wasn't because she was encouraged and nurtured to go in that direction. Here's a great career for you. Why don't you go be a prostitute? Oh, goody. No, she was, how did she get there? We don't know how she got there. Maybe she had no husband and no family and was starving. And she did this to survive. Maybe she was sold into it. Sometimes parents would sell their children because they needed cash. Do you imagine the shame she carried, piled onto her by the Pharisees and by the good people? But she anointed Jesus because she honored and respected him. And so what did Simon the Pharisee say? What's the one thing he said? Oh, if that Jesus were a prophet, he would know she's a sinful woman. No one touched each other's feet in public ever. I mean, people didn't kiss. You know, you didn't have, like, at a dinner and someone's kissing. She's kissing his feet, but she's a really virtuous woman. No one ever did that. And the one thing Simon noticed and the one thing that caught his attention was that Jesus somehow didn't know that this woman was a sinner. And he said, what did he do? Did he do like he did in Matthew chapter 23, where he's having a fight with the Pharisees? And he says, hypocrites, you're from, you know, what else did he call them? Whitewashed tombs. I mean, Jesus was just, in Matthew chapter 23, Jesus laid into the Pharisees, just handed them their heads. Is that what he did here? He didn't. He was gentle. He was patient. He was kind. Simon dealt him the greatest public insult that he could in that day and age. You know, it'd be like when someone walks into your house saying, hey, you idiot. You know, I mean, he just gave Jesus the ultimate public insult. And Jesus had every right as God, King, Messiah, Rabbi, to rebuke him. And he didn't. He said, Simon, I have something to ask you. Something to tell you. And then he told him a story. And then he said, Simon, what do you think? He asked for his opinion. Simon was able to teach the lesson on Jesus' behalf. And then he kind of called him out. But look at how he did it. It was so gentle. And everybody in that room would have known that what Simon had done was wrong. They all knew it anyway. We've been there when someone's being wronged and someone's being hurt and it happens in front of us and we're shocked and we don't know what to do. They all knew it was wrong and they all stood there and watched it happen. And Jesus said, she has honored me. And he said, because though her sins be many, she leaves here today forgiven. And the people were shocked. He even forgave sin. Well, he'd already healed the sick and raised the dead and changed the weather. And he even forgives sin. But just so that woman could walk out of there with something, he said, okay, your faith has saved you. And Jesus has done that more than once. Now, the question I have, I hope this kind of expands the story and helps you understand why people were doing what they did, why it wasn't so strange that this woman was kissing his feet. And it wasn't so strange that she was honoring him in a way that she all that she could do to honor him when others had dishonored him. But the question I have for us this morning as we close is, who am I at the table? Am I the sinful person? I mean, it could have just, you know, this really happened, but it was easiest for people in that day and age to see a prostitute. It could have been a tax collector, a man, and they would have hated him and felt just about the same. A sinful man. They hated the tax collectors. And it wasn't in this case, but it could have been. Is that me? That is me. I am that person. My sins are many. Seriously. Because God is perfect. God is sinless. God is flawless. And Jesus was the same. So when I compared to him, my sins are many, beyond counting. And he freely forgives me. Though I come to him and ask for forgiveness, and I don't really know what to do, and I'm clumsy, and if Jesus were in the room, I'd probably embarrass myself, just as this woman did. She did things that were embarrassing to everybody. He didn't see that. Jesus didn't call her out. He named all of Simon's sinful actions, and then when he came to that woman, he said, you are forgiven, though your sins be many. He didn't call her out. Why? Because she was repentant. She wanted forgiveness. And guess what? Love keeps no record of wrongs. God keeps no record of my wrongs. I'm forgiven. He won't throw it back in my face, no matter how bad I was the other day. And I asked forgiveness for him. It's not fair, but I'm forgiven. And I can walk out of his presence free. Only problem is, who else am I at that table? I'm also the Pharisee. I am that Pharisee. Because I don't feel like a sinner. I feel like a really nice guy. Y'all like me, don't you? Well, some of you may. Well, let me see. Don't have my glasses on. I can't see. You're pretty nice, too. You know, none of us are sinners. This must not be about us. This must be about someone else. We are good people. I haven't killed anybody. I haven't stolen. Okay, I drive over the speed limit. But that's no big deal. In fact, none of the sinful thoughts that I have or the sinful actions I do are really that big of a deal. Compared to myself and compared to all of us, we're all good people. We are doing the right things. And what Jesus has for me when I'm the Pharisee is a gentle rebuke. Because there's no way I can really fully love Christ and what he has given for me when I consider my sin to be this small. Because in truth, my sin is a giant, if it were water, it'd fill a giant ocean. And there would be God, you know, sitting in judgment, and there would be with a bucket trying to bail the ocean out. Just give me a second, I'll get rid of it. Give me a second, I'll get rid of it. And I would rather think of myself as a good person. So, you know, I happen to be Simon the Pharisee sometimes too. Now, what do we learn from this? Well, what we learn from this account is that even the religious sinner, Simon the Pharisee, has available to him forgiveness. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just. Faithful. I love that word. Faithful. I just love it. To forgive us our sins and do what? Cleanse us from how much unrighteousness? Oh. Even the Pharisee gets it. And he's patient with me when I'm a Pharisee. He waits. He gently calls me to repentance. He doesn't smack me over the head like I deserve. Instead, he has offered the blood of Christ. Jesus offered himself on the cross for the Pharisee and the sinner. So, one last question. Who's the Pharisee in your life? I don't mean you. I mean the other person that's the Pharisee. Who's the sinner in your life? And how close are you to writing them off? Love is patient. Love is kind. Now, I always make a point of saying love does not mean you're in a relationship where you're getting abused and you're putting up with abuse. It never means that. There's a whole message about that. But it also means that there's someone in my life that is the Pharisee, and I want to just say, done. No more chances. You're through. Get out. And there's also that person that's the sinner that is just doesn't get it, doesn't know Christ, doesn't realize that they need to know Jesus, and I'm just sort of, you know, I'm tired. Jesus is patient with me. Jesus is kind to me when I sin. What a blessing. This week, we have an opportunity to be Jesus to everyone around us, to the sinner and to the saint. Let's pray. Lord, you are worthy of all the honor I can offer you. You are worthy of praise through song. You are worthy of my time reading the word and praying. You are worthy of my devotion. Lord, I ask that you would receive this from us, though we're not great at it. I ask that you would receive it from us as worship. And today, as we celebrate communion, that we would celebrate the freedom you offer, your kindness, even when we, those of us forgiven, those of us saved, go back and sin again, you offer us grace again and again and again, and we thank you for that. And I ask you, God, that as we take this communion today, we would also celebrate the love and kindness of Christ that we can share with those around us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Adam. We're going to take our time, as we usually do every Sunday, and take a moment to pray. Let's remember those who have needs. Let's think about what we have learned from Scripture today. we are going to prepare for our time of communion. We are going to handle this the way we have done in the past, so there won't be ushers passing the elements. We're going to ask that you come up, not all at the same time, but in turns, and take of the bread and the cup and go back to the seat, and then we will share in communion together. So please stand and come take care of the elements here. And we do not have the words on the screen, so we'll do it the old-fashioned way. We'll read it from God's Word. So I'm reading from 1 Corinthians here, chapter 11, and starting with verse 23. For I have received from the Lord that which I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's take and eat. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you drink it in remembrance of me. Let's take and drink. Let's sing one more song together before we go. Glory to God forever. We'll be right back.
God forever.
Yeah, I didn't know it ended there either. Hey, thanks for coming and worshiping with us today. Make sure you connect with somebody here before you leave, and have a great week.